and then talking to them. So you see that the magnetic system is quite important topic for the how the internet operations happen.
And including the design for inductor and transformer, they are also important.
So you can see that the transformer inductor account for the biggest component in all the switchable power conversion system. And the thing is, when you use high frequency, you're able to detect the size of L and the transformer is needed. But for the magnetic design, these are not all things, we're not quite sure about it. So in this lecture, we can go through them so you understand how to design the transformer and also inductor. The most important thing will be about the waveform. For switchable power supply or power electronics, we usually using square wave. But of course, when we go for the low frequency 50 Hz, then the main difference is that will be linear for sine wave. So the design for transformer inductor under sine wave and also square wave are quite different. So we take account for that. The main thing is we are looking here because we want to make use of high frequency effect. So using high frequency, we of course are able to receive a lot of the component size. But having said that, we also increase other problems. For example, like the losses, high frequency losses, then the skin effect, external loss, proximity effect, that's all the things we need to overcome. So in this lecture, we show you some basic information about the area and also go through some design requirements. So one of the things we talk about inductor design will be, and we have to go through all these losses and losses. We understand how to calculate the initial magnetic effect. We also need to look into the material, for example, the material has saturation, and we also work on linear region for magnetic material. And even though for certain materials, they also have different requirements and criteria. So all these things will be important to design. Not only this one, also material cost. Some materials, they are really low loss, but they are really expensive. And we also relate how many certain number of time we need for the component. You see, in part of guy, we usually tend to make our own transformer data. We not go to buy one. Of course, you can go to shop to buy a data transformer. Of course, you do it understand how to do your whole wire, and wire transformer. Have a wire and data, and then you can develop a prototype. Of course, after that, and once you've got a prototype, you know how to do the design, and then you use it for the mass production. So the lecture here is to show you we're able to do our own design for magnets. How to remind it, how to do the time to use it, how to avoid all this design information. So this lecture is quite very important so that we understand the other domain for the magnets. So firstly, we go for a few things for you. There's a basic equation formulation for the initial magnet. Of course, the Faraday's law of internal operation. Then we know the inductive EMF will be equal to the N phi, that means it's the total leakage, total first leak, and then the length, how many number of turns. So of course, everybody knows about this equation. Another equation we need to know about it will be so-called the MP slope. And one term is so-called the first linkage, so that's quite an important term as well. We all know the first. First linkage means how the first can link all the coils. With one quantity of thrust, then it pass through one coil, then you got N5, two coils for two, and so on. So more of a current in the first linkage will therefore increase. So we also need to understand the meaning of the first linkage. Actually, I try to ask many students if they know the first linkage meaning of you will understand. So we can also understand the first linkage. So that means the first linkage is something highly related to the relational. Because when we have changed in the first linkage, they will create this kind of the inductive EMF. And when the equation is saying MP slope, then we have MP slope here, which try to encode the amount of current. So that means the amount of current you can encode it, then between stress and loop, then you can use it to define how much the material can experience by this amount of current. Notice that this N here, so that would mean how many winding of current. If we have one winding, then we can get one for many winding. If the MP slope can encode them as well, then we can see that there are no of the effect into this curve. So these two are the two basic equations we have for all these equations we deal with for transformers and inductors.
So next one is a more basic thing on the brain. So you see we've got very simple basic transformer. You've got the primary input into here, and then you've got a secondary output here. So we can still use things that the right hand grip more to extend our both the direction of the graph generator. So we've got input, okay, like this. Now current going into here, and the finger will point to the graph direction. So that's the primary. So you see the first do that. So the current going into here, and then the first going into the direction. And then how do we look into the current come out? So we can also use this work by hand as well, and then all these first direction, and then get the current come out in the reverse direction. So that's how we also define the two dot locations. So that's important, because the dot location tells us the line direction, tells us how the current goes in and come out. So that's a way to understand how to define a stop location so that you know how to define your polarity for a transformer. Of course, in many cases, then the people will have a certain time may not be the same phase, then this one goes to transpire. So we also need to be using my method to define the direction when the current comes out and also how the first beam generates. So for pure transformer, easy for our analysis, even to get our student winding resistant, negligible, and into our perfectly coupled, so that the primary voltage and the secondary voltage, they do have a correlation relationship according to the tensor result. I think we all know about that. So the basic thing about the transformer. So now to go to a more basic thing about the waveform. First of all, we are doing a transformer. So we usually define the look into the sine wave, find the transformer. So the sine wave go in and come out with the sine wave itself. So what do you think is a square wave to the transformer? In the second sign, what wave want to come out? But that is still a square wave or become a sine wave or become a triangular wave, become pulsation wave, become a sharp edges. So what do you think about it? How does that mean? What do you think? Square wave, the transformer time is what do you reckon?
The implied sinusoid, so will you get the same?
But that will be our first sine wave, of course, to get the same. We know that we did that in time, so we still have transformer. But what my question asking will be, if this is square wave applied to the primary side, what will happen to the secondary side? Yeah. And what is our curve? We have a good input square wave, output will be.
You go in, then whatever you come out, as long as still the linear law, loss, etc. So you see that, first of all, you know that when we have a slide, we can explain to you why that. Because once we apply a square wave in the primary side, so according to the Faraday's law, then the first developed in the transformer will be the equation of the voltage. So now that for this section, the voltage is constant, the square wave. When you integrate this one, then that will be become linear increasing direction. Just from where this one. And then when the voltage become negative, so that will become negative. When you integrate it, that become decreasing slow and so on. So obviously, when you apply a square wave into a transformer, you expect that the electron development will be very well according to this relationship. Let's not forget it. So next, if you got this kind of magnetic flux inside the transformer, then in the secondary side, you calculate what kind of voltage is developed, we just defense straight the magnetic flux to get that voltage.
simply traditional. So if you mention this one, of course you're DC, this one, of course you're DC as before. So that's why, using this method, I'm sure that input squaring, output is squaring, and also squaring. Just from the traditional. Then you may try using another waveform to check if the gravitational to see it come out with the same kind of waveform. If you try that at home, I'm sure it will be the same way. As long as the transformer is ideal transformer, then maybe you can try the transformer still in the linear mode. Then you compare to what we learned in the past for the sinusoidal waveform for transformer. So if I apply a sinusoidal waveform like a cosine waveform here, after integration of cosine, of course, the sine wave with the sine wave curve plus will appear in the transformer. And then, in the second design, we therefore differentiate this one for better cosine waveform. So this tool is limited. So that will say, under ideal case of transformer, curve transformer, the primary input gauge and second input gauge will be the same kind of waveform. Of course, the MC will be different because the and then another thing will be about if we apply the second sign, we're using a pure resistor, then of course the current waveform will be the same as the voltage waveform. So let me say that if I have a second sign, we have a square waveform, and if connected with a resistor R, then the waveform will also become square wave. So this sinusoidal current will therefore be reflected in the primary side. Use an emitter to measure the current in the primary side, which should measure what will be reflected from the second side. But there will be another exception, because the second output current will be reflected in the primary side. So using a transformer transistor. But there's another current we need to consider, which is magnetizing current. The magnetizing current actually will be in a kind of way which will be proportional to each other. Magnetizing current and magnetizing flux are proportional to each other. And basically, it will due to the Ampere's law. Later, I will show you exactly how the Ampere's law comes from. So, which will basically from this equation, the magnetizing flux and magnetizing current, which is just a linear relationship. So, linear resistance, they will be proportional to each other. So they basically also from the Ampere's law. If they try to set an Ampere's law, you see how much the N linked with the current that has just come out will therefore be proportional to each other. So that means we do have a magnetizing current. If you look at transformer, the T model, then you go to the first transformer. That will be the magnetizing inductance. So we got the magnetizing current, look like we go into here. So that's the second side current, and then we pack back into here, then it will be IS. We better understand it as the ISD. So this current and this current add together will be actual current from the input side, how we measure it. So X, S, like this two current add together, appear in here. That's why when we have secondary side current plus the magnetizing current, these two add together will become this waveform. So actually, when you measure the primary current, will not square wave, will be like that. Of course, I make it more saturated so that you see the gradient here. But in fact, usually this magnetizing current will be really small, so about 1%, even less than that. That's a 2%. So this current will be really, really small. So this gradient of this loop will be really small, maybe look like a square wave anyway. So I do like that so that I can see better. You can see better. So that's how the all the waveform for square wave explanation for transformer. You can double check with what happened in the transformer. So again, the magnetic current should be the same kind of waveform as the flux. So also a sine wave. the current that will be divided from the voltage. So if the voltage is cosine, if the AC still resistor, then current will also become cosine waveform. So now then, this reflected back to the primary sign also cosine waveform. So the input sign from the sinusoidal transformer will be this curve, adding this metallic current will become also a sinusoidal, but because the summation of two then sine and cosine, that will face angle. So that's why the waveform actually will be delayed slightly by small face angle due to the metallic. So usually that face angle will be very, very, very small, you can't alter that because the metallic current is so small. But if you do it more carefully, you see that there was more time on that face angle, but then the delay. The waveform will be really much the same. So that's how we distinguish between the sine and square wave estimation of transformer. So the all basic things I think you all learned in the year 1 or 2 when you did the GUI course. Alright? Any questions of this one? Very important equation we have learned will be the transformer voltage related to the magnetic flux equation. I think you all know about this equation. The magnetic flux for transformer, you will read over 4.44. It's a really famous constant. And then tap N. Do you know about this equation? Transformer magnetic flux equation. I think you all learned that in year 1 and 2. So we are using coefficient 4.44. I think you also divide that. But for square wave operation, then that will change to 4. V over 4 and N becomes the magnetic flux, not 4.4. So as we say, for sine wave and square wave excitation, the magnetic flux for a transformer under the same time of pitch will be different. 4 compared to 4.44. So I would like you now to try to divide yourself how to obtain this expression. I'll give you about 2-3 minutes to try yourself how to get to this equation. This basic thing here and stuff is able to do it. So you see that try to do the delivery for this waveform. For example, right here, when we have DC voltage, like this one, then the flux will change from the maximum to another maximum. Or the recent waveform is here, you see that that is the maximum, and this will go. So we've been on half of favorite. When we integrate this voltage, you go. The flux will travel two of the maximum energy. So that means from this equation, let me know that two of the flux maximum energy, therefore equal to 1 over mp. And then we integrate the voltage for half a period. So that is equal to constant voltage. Obviously, this will equal to Vn. So the period will be T over 2. So from this expression, obviously, we can reduce it. So that means that phi n will therefore equal the 2 over to here, V, n over T will be 1 over F, therefore, becomes 4. For square wave, then the maximum voltage equal to power and the square wave. So that's why this will also be power less over 4 and T. So that's very simple linear integration. Then you talk about that. The key thing is the coefficient n here. Something you need to be close to. Alright? You all get it? It's very simple. So that's the basic behind it for the transformer. want to try to divide 4444. 4444 was similar, just using integration. Then you can divide. So let's try to do the look at this one. If you want to divide this one, you just we see that the Kosari form when we travel from here and here, which is R2. Then the method first will come 0 go up to 5 method. Okay. So that's to say if you follow the equation, the 5 method will therefore equal to 1 over MP integrate of this waveform, which is will be maximum cosine omega t dt, and from 0 to this period. So that means eventually, again, go to that one, we add 9 omega t to that one, divided by omega, and then we will have for 0, 0, 4, but that will equal to 1 anyway, so that means 1 Vn over Mp, so I. And then we try to get into the from the Vm, we want to change the Rms. So that will become 2 Vrms over Mp to I, and so now then go to Vrms, and then this will be F Mp. So this will be 2 I over 2, so that will be 2 to. According to the calculator, will be 4.44 Mp. So that's how we get to this situation. The time for me is go up, so 2 is 4.44. So that's how we get into this basic equation. So both of them are just using the first principle for the first base law. We can divide the correlation between the vector part and also a point voltage to the transform. So these two are very basic equations. The transform equation, I think you learned in A1, but this one is just music. I remind you, you must understand how to do it. It's also careful, you need to know how to do it. Right. Any question on this one? Is it too simple to learn in the class? Good. So let's look at this page. Just now I mentioned to you about this relationship between the vector plus the transformer related to the metasynchronous IA. So of current, you can measure by receiving the inside is a kind of imaginary current. Just like this current, you cannot take out any kind of measure internally. Impossible. And of course, you use open circuit to do that, you still have the IA transformer. So this kind of metasynchronous current is also divided basically from the Ampere's law. So from the Ampere's law, if we go back to the MP law, then we have the MP law, what's one way? You know that from the MP law, which has a equation, which is y h dl equal to the number of current and the curve. So we get the MP law. Then how we get to that one? First of all, that's the each field, of course, choose the B field, I think it's a bit more easy than the test level. And of course, it's your B field. And the end bit loop is here. We integrate about the cross integral of end bit loop. So that will be integral around the magic path. Magic path will be mean how the magic being traveled from the loop. So that means in here, that will be equal to LM. And then N, of course, will be the number of turns in here. And then the current expansion will be our magnetizing current. But when I change to B, then we need to insert the permeability in the equation, which is mu naught and also mu r. So that's directly from the M slope, you can get back to this equation. We want to get to the magnetic thrust rather than the magnetic thrust density, so that therefore change in the magnetic thrust over A, Ln equal to Mg, In, mu naught, so I guess if you want to get the magnetizing current, the magnetizing current will therefore equal to directly from here, Ln over the A, so this will move to the other side. And we will lock it up. So that's how we get divide the magnetic current for transformer. Basically, again, from the end spot. And another thing will be what is meaning for a magnetic thrust. The magnetic thrust will be. If you do have a magnetic equal for some rising here, if the rising here, we're expecting the magnetic thrust will be traveled for one turn of the magnetic path. So the thrust will therefore go in here, this is half a back. Will be like that. So this, the length here, will be our magnetic path length. So you have to understand that. Therefore, that will be from equal. Then, of course, for equal, it's slightly different, for toric, it's different. So, this example is how the magnetic path will be go, and that's the magnetic loop. Okay, about the magnetic. Okay, so that's how we'll go to this magnetic. So, that's to say, you can also, using my equation here, you can extend and calculate about the magnetic current. From there, you can know how the magnetic current is. Transform design to see if that was too large or too small. Now, always recommend to you magnetic current less than 10% of main current, maybe even 1% will feel better. Of course, when you have to reduce the magnetic current, then you need to know about how to do the design of operating. So, you need to manipulate of this parameter in order to control the magnetic current. For example, if you want to reduce the magnetic current, make it to increase the number of turns. But when you increase the number of turns, then somehow the magnetic will also increase as well. So that's the main thing correlated to each other. So that's both of the base equation divided from the Faraday's law and Henry's law. So here you got all the base equation. Now you know how to divide all the equations. So this is really important to understand how to do the high frequency magnetic design. Alright, any questions after this one? Next thing, we can look into the voltage conversion. For transformer, of course, we know that basic this conversion is due to the first phase, which is the regular voltage related to the second size and about the third phase. I think everybody knows about this equation. Of course, the V is meant the magnetizing voltage next to the magnetic transformer. Usually, but the actual measurable voltage will also include the leakage arc within the winding resistance. But in most cases, then, we assume the leakage arc of winding resistance is really small, then we still assume this voltage ratio related to term ratio as such. So then assume it's an ideal transformer. So this is a rule basic equation for the low voltage. And if under a pure resistor condition, the current will be in a current relationship, will be also pretty with the working relationship, but will be inverse. So you see that the bigger the sign, okay, then you prepare to the dollar sign, you also using this terminal relationship. You do that. So obviously, you see that this will be upside down as compared to what this is. I think we all know about this basic equation. So now then, let's go back to some next equation for transform. Okay, I know most of you have learned that in the past. Firstly, we go into an ideal transformer. In the primary sign, we've got cell less than L11. And in the second sign, we've got cell less than L22. So between the two coils, we've got the real conductance L12. So if you do that, then we know that the voltage equation for a transformer will be V1 under some voltage equal to the voltage divided by cell resistance, which L1 D1 dt, plus the new conductance derived from the second line current, which will be L2 D2 dt. So that's basic equation for transformer. We know it. If we observe from the second line, then we can see really to write down this equation. So this equation, simultaneous equation, we have been using for many years. But what I want is how to use these two equations to a very step into a T-mode or transform. To do this one, then you do some manipulation. So this even equation may be right in here, but what we try to do will be we deliberately minus this term in here. That not exist, but deliberately minus this term and add back up this term in here. So we clearly the equation, it will be unchanged. Similarly, we can do the same thing for V2, subtract this term, and then we add back this term here. So now that happened to be the magnetizing method, we have two curves, I1 and I2 go in the magnetizing, so that you can look like these two curves, all flow in the magnetizing. So we can use one magnetizing method for these two curves. And then we found that the iron current here will therefore look like the only the difference between these two. So that will tell us this will look like the leak gauge inductance. Similarly, we can get the same thing for V2 equation. So this equation will trigger us to write down kind of the T model of transform. You can see that I1 and I2 all go in little to zero voltage for the magnetizing. M2 1. The current will pass through this differential inductance, which will be now become a leakage. This will also become a leakage. So that is one of the popular models we have been using in the house in the T1, the equations of the T1. Obviously, this tool we call them the leakage inductance. For understanding this time. This is only for ideal transformer. So this for pressure is on the other copper loss, R1, R2, for the lighting losses. So that the lighting position can be here or here. So the person presents the lighting. Then somebody will also put another resistor across here to represent the core loss. Similar what we did last week for the brushless flow water, we have to insert the model for core loss. Core loss is what appears in the original model. But we just put the core loss there to represent the losses due to the iron loss of the core loss. So that's why the primary the model will become like that for all the magnetizing part. And this is the core loss, this is the inductance part for the magnetizing pattern. Then we observe this is the leakage. This leakage, mining resistance. Before the dash shear, represent the whole thing to be reflected to the primary side. So that's how we understand it. This is how the basic string we understand for the transformer, how to get to the T model, with the consideration of the losses component. So the other losses, which is the iron losses or the core loss, will be usually formulated by this equation. This is only an empirical formula, it's not an equation can be run easily. So usually we use measurement to measure the core loss according to the quantity of the frequency and the magnetic field density. and then from there we can work out the conclusion. We usually found that for different material, then the frequency loss index, the 1.3 to 2.0, and also the B field will be 2 to 2.7. So that's to say, the core loss will be increased rapidly with the magic field. So that's something we do quite like that. And also increase quite rapidly with the frequency. So that's to say, a core loss will be quite seriously a high frequency of pressure. So that's to say, some kind of material we need to select properly, so that we ensure that our transformer will be pitched really well with the low loss component under high frequency. And because the highly delayed magnetic field, so somehow high frequency, the transformer or inductor tend to operate a lower field. If they always operate at a saturated field via the saturation, then the loss will be very high. So for my design, I tend to change the B field to much lower than the saturation. So here will be some discussion. So the losses will be covered usually by the manufacturer, leadership, but they're more accurate because they tell you exactly what happened. There's no formulation. Even though your formula only using the perfect thing of the manufacturer measure. So in general, most of the is using for the transforming method, the saturation trust will be close to 0.3, will be 0.4. So anything close to that, then the transform getting close to the saturation. So we try to avoid it. So we usually try to work on a design of transformer somewhere 0.3 or below. That would be better. Then we found that if you use hard iron core, then the saturation trust will use it above 0.7, which is really good. But of course, the hard iron core, the permeability is not as good as the ferrite. Ferrite can usually achieve a good function of the permeability. But however, for hard iron, it uses a quite small Fourier 10 or 300. So sometimes we have to think about what's the best solution. For core loss is a concern because as I mentioned, high frequency, the losses will be much higher. So that's why we need to look into that. So for my recommendation, I usually try to trim down the B field when you design transformer. For example, I usually give you about a tenth of kilohertz of the distributed, I tend to use 0.1 around this range. I won't go for 0.3, it's too high. The losses is too high. And if you go for megahertz operation, then the D field will tend to work at 0.03, about 30 millitesla. So that is something we want to go for. If you understand 0.3 and megahertz operation will be too serious, the loss will be too high. At the moment, the material may not be able to cope with that. So as I say, the core loss we use is using the manufacturer data. So many manufacturer data are using some kind of this format. The X axis will be about the B field, magic field density. So you can see that the magic field, and then for that green line here, that will be measured according to the previous operation. And then if you see that your frequency, you set a B field using log table method or graph method, then you can know the property of the losses. The losses component usually will be in terms of density, like the loss per unit volume or per unit weight. Depending on the manufacturer. The losses usually will help everything, including the electrical loss in the core or hysteresis loss or maybe the losses will be all included here. So my recommendation will be use log table to get your loss data. This kind of core loss material data will also related to temperature. So temperature will be one of the governing factor for the losses. So the check what kind of temperature will be for the bomb. So usually high temperature, expecting the losses to be increased as well. And then the core loss, of course, we know that the transistor loss is very important for transformer and also in that design. But this kind of transistor loss is also called the copper loss. Basically, we'll be using the I square R method to calculate the current square multiplied by the resistance. But of course, the resistance is to be careful the high frequency, the DC resistance will not be the one we use. We use this AC resistance for wiring. For AC resistance compared to DC, actually, AC much usable. The higher it increase the frequency. So we will put in a FR, this kind of ratio in here. So that is to say, high frequency, AC resistance will be a number of times of the DC resistance. The ratio will be about FR. So this is a kind of the main coefficient we use to indicate the DC resistance. FR, this number, DC condition, has been defined. High frequency can be 2, 3, 5, 10, or 100, depending on how high frequency it is. One step again, for a copper loss, we have those things called C effect. The C effect, in order that all the electrons will tend to go to C. And also, proximity effect, that means when we have adjacent magnetic field near the binding, then you affect the distribution of the electron and copper. So, you also affect the resistance. So all these things will be quite important. We will explain them to be more detailed. So this is an example that shows you the ratio, how the AC resistance increase. So usually the ratio for you to work. FR is a ratio which is very primary for pressure. So this actually is a complex number. The real part will be related to the resistance part. The resistance part will be related to the resistance part. The more in here we more concerned with the real part, that means resistance part because we are concerned about the losses. So you can see that under the DC condition, here at low frequency, the ratio is 1. As the frequency increase, then it will also increase rapidly. So horizontal line is actually normalized my size. So we try to normalize it using some parameter, which is not covered in the series. I'll show you more detail in our paper. So they're normalized together with the skin depth. Skin depth is another term we use it to define the how the electron will flow. So usually skin depth will mean most of the electron will flow within certain regions. So in here you can see that so at high frequency the AC resistance ratio can increase quite a few times, something 10 times of surprising, sometimes can increase to tens of hundreds. So that's why you need to be very careful. Another important thing we're going to look at into will be another leak gauge. For design transformer, we know how to design a metal inductor. If you basically just using the inductor formula, you will use the inductor proportional to n squared. So very important thing we need to look into a leakage, don't have any formula. So the formula is quite difficult. So here we try to propose to you for the method we can derive the leakage inductance. The leakage inductance is mainly highly related to the leakage field. In the air. So that means the magnetic field is not linking the main thrust, then it becomes the leakage field. The leakage field therefore affecting the inductor. We create a certain inductor which is quite light. So this inductor is not able to merge with the magnet. The main magnet is the inductor. So we can estimate the leakage to find the number of the method. So this I'm going to show you what I'm able to consider the nuclear inductance. So seriously, for instance, if you've got a forward converter, if you've got a forward converter, just like a back converter with a transformer. So you can see that in the secondary side, then if the voltage, you just change from low voltage or some voltage change into voltage from the secondary side. Once the signal side of voltage appears, you can imagine if the output current or the inductor current output, the low current is here equal to constant. So that means always being constant. So before the voltage appears in the secondary side, and this current must be still appearing in here, through, that means ID 1 with green green curve. Once the second side working appears, so this voltage will be trying to apply across this portion. Because the preview ring, this star is conducting, so this will be a short circuit. So that means this voltage is trying to apply across this gating, which the leakage has to be fed to the transformer. Because the leakage, this voltage cannot appear across here instantly. Need to charge up the leakage. So now then, may I this voltage apply across the leakage induction? So the current in the leakage or ID2 or ILK will therefore increase gradually in the manner of the delay to the leakage. So it takes some time to reach the overcurrent reservation then simultaneously ID1 drops to zero. And so that means this will therefore become reverse bias. So this voltage will therefore apply across here. So you can see that because the leakage, it got to this second side voltage, it waits until the current increase to the upper stage. So this kind of delay will cause the voltage across here, VD1, instead become full voltage in here, but delayed by this amount. So this is the region called overlapping the D delay, which is the main energetic gauge current to increase to the IL. So this delay is a little more than one. Because originally the second time was appearing in here, but now because the current increasing, the current, the voltage in the second side will appear later, delayed by this amount of time. So what happens is, our voltage is equal to every voltage across this line. If this voltage becomes delayed, the average of voltage will also become less. You can see that if the overlapping time is extended to really large, then the voltage will be dropping. So you can see that if this delay is 1 millisecond, if the whole switching period will be 10 milliseconds, then at least 10% of this time will disappear. So that means the whole drop will be quite low. The average voltage can appear will be less than what is better. So that's why we don't want any leakage, because leakage will be reduced our voltage. You see that if leakage is really large or the under the higher current, then the voltage drop will be quite more. And also if the switching period is really high switching frequency, then this period will be much shorter, then the ratio for this overlapping time will be more significant. So the effect of the move drop will be even worse. So that's why we tend to reduce the leakage. So that's why for any SMPS design, we need to understand how to design, understand how much the leakage is. So let's see how we look into the leakage in SMPS. So this one model we are using. So what that model here in the different transformer, the V4 transformer, like this one. So we've got the primary side rising in here, and the secondary side rising in the outer portion. So this area, we call that the winding window. And in the window, we can do the winding. So this, now hope is here. So this L is the center line for the E core. So you see that this is a group of winding, the edge of the strand here, each of the line here will be carry current island with totally random number of turns. And then in the secondary side, the current I2 with N2 number of turns. Obviously, N1 island will give the N2 I2 because of the transformer relationship. Another terminology I'm going to show you is so called the NMF, natural moving force. So, what I'm trying to say will be, when we apply MVC loop, so the MVC loop will try to enclose amount of current in here. The more current encloses, then the more MMF can ever develop according to the MVC loop. So that means near that line, the MMF encloses, we use zero. If the angle here, we don't enclose anything, we use zero. That is to say, and that is from the leakage field will be equal to small. Here, inside here, main field, here will be in the area we call the leakage field. So this field will be small. The question is if it can cause more current or have more current in here, then the leakage field will go up. Or so the MMF will then go up the maximum. And then this current, this current should be equal in, should be the value will be equal in the MMF, but in different direction. R1 and R2 will be different in direction. If one is going in, the other one will come out. So that's R will be negative. So this when it encodes more current in here, then this will be dropping, and it will go back to zero. So if the MP group encodes four of them, these two that it adds together should equal to zero. So that means this case we're expecting will increase from zero to the maximum in here and drop down to zero. Because once the leakage field margin here usually will be equal to zero. So that's how we experiment about the leakage in inductance. So we firstly try to make use of the leakage field here of full MMF, and then the MMF we develop the graphical presentation will be like that. And then later on we can using this graph to calculate how much is the leakage field and also leakage inductance. The leakage inductance mainly will be calculated all the press linkage in here, so that you can up the press linkage, and therefore calculate back if you have a leakage inductance. So that's a break now for about 10 minutes, and then continue. So just now in the break, someone asked me what's the correlation between the leakage field and the main field. So our leakage field means when the current is here, this kind of the current is considered the leakage. So the field in the air in this location is the leakage, because the field is not going to contribute the main, but only experience in this location. So that we say you can see that if you use the amplitude to encode temperature here, then because the symmetrical between I1, M1, I1, and I2, so the encoder will be equal to zero, so that means if you point is here, so this point will not experience this and this information because this two will cash out. When you have a point in here, because this two is symmetrical, so when you have a point here, so all the MLF will be cashed out, so this point will have do not experience any leakage. When you make those in here, because when a point in here, we could experience some of the MF, some of the MF here, but these two are not symmetrical, so definitely this point will experience some kind of the MF because I'm balanced, so there will be some leakage from this point. So outside in here and here, so which these two are symmetrical, then we cannot experience any leakage here. So this is actually the main field. When we have minor in here, the main field will travel inside the core. So this is the field when it travels inside the core, it contributes to the magnetizing. It's not contributing to the leakage. So but this field, this current, this number of turns is here, will only contribute the field in the air. So that's our leakage field under our construction. So that's how we see that at this point, when we put the order in here, this point will be zero and then minus that because this two already cancelled. Because this N2, I2, and M and I1 must be equal to each other. So that's why at this point we do not experience any MMF. So but now we go up to here, then in this point we have maximum in here. And then we go down to here, this point, this one will cancel out, so we no MMF. So the key thing is the leakage field is only linked to the air, not to the metal core. When it links to the metal core, that's the main field. So what we're trying to calculate here, how this current and number of current will affect and contribute the leakage in the air, not in here. So in the metal core, it will be much easier to calculate. You can use conventional in the equation, but when it's linked with this air within this minor window, that's the difficult part, because that only contribute by the MMF. So let's go this way. The PE if you here expect that the MMF will increase from this point, gradually increase up to here. So that means from origin here, from zero, increase gradually up to this point. So this point, this MMF loop will increase all the N9. So that means in this point will be the N1 time. So you use one coordinate x in here. We assume that x is this coordinate we try to examine is meeting. Because this is a linear relationship, the measurement is equal to Vm. So that by Vx, we therefore need random Vm in a proportional manner, x over V1. This is just a linear relationship from this point. And what is the value for Vm? Vm is basically divided from the integral, which is basically from this kind of equation. So because that's in the air, so that why the variability will be equal to mu log. The current enclosed M1 ion is here. The pathway equal to LC. Then you ask me, what are the power in LC? What the whole mechanics? Because they talk about the leakage field, only the field in the air. So if the field is there, the rest of them will be the magnetic core. In the magnetic core, the mu r will be too large, it's not leakage. So that's why the magnetic power only using LC, which is different. So from this equation, we can cut out the maximum BQPN. Next, we try to work out the flux at point B here. Now use the relationship. So delta X is actually changed in the X. We call delta X. And the LT is the mean trending. What mean turning here would be, means at a particular point here, the mean turning means the magnetic flux will go through this whole, this one turn length. So for example, right in this here, one turn will be so the mean turning. Of course, the mean turning will be different from the innermost and to the outermost, but it's just saying average. So as we say, we consider there's a circle here, of the one turn, the derivative of the displacement x here, when the field goes in here, this ring will therefore be impressed by the magnetic field. So that's why from this equation you can see that this is the ring length multiplied by the displacement. So that will be the area of the one turn here. The area multiplied by the B field goes through the ring, so that would be the magnetic flux. So that differential equation is to develop by the little bit change in the flux or little bit change in the X. Obviously, the BX. We can therefore relate it from this equation, so put back this equation into this equation. So that's why we get this expression now. So we start to develop the differential equation for small change in the flux at x form to small change in the x dimension, coordinate x. So to get the first linkage, we need to add up all the flux together with the number of turns. But the average loop will enclose more number of turns when the x increases. Why is that? Because you see that at this point, it only enclose zero number of turns. And here, it can call angle number 2. The middle may be angle number 2. So when the x increase, the number 2 in quotient will also be increased in linear manner. So that's why if you want to get the plus linkage, you integrate from 0 to V1, that means the dimension. You integrate from this point to V1 here. And along the changing is here, the amount of the number turn and cost will increase with x. So the maximum number turn M1, the number turn increase will be x over V1, it's linear relationship. When x equals 0, that's why I cross any number of turns. When x equals V1, the number of turns equals M1. So this kind is all the number of turns modified by the small change in the thrust. So this will be our plus linkage. So we integrate from 0 to V1 to have all the plus linkage together. That will be the plus linkage for all the linkage field. So this term in number of turns and quotient. And this is small change of the thrust at x form. So now then, this is the equation. I need to integrate the equation to get back to the real thrust. So after integration, we'll go to this expression. So could you take a 2 minutes to see if you can obtain this thrust linkage. So now then, let's see how we use the plus linkage to work out the inductance. So we have this equation now, which is known as how much the number of turns being changed and the coordinate of x. So from this equation, then we can carry out together with two equations to develop two equations. So that's to say, remember these two equations add together, then the plus linkage is 100 sine, which is equal to 0, V1, then x over v1, and then this, when delta is so small, we change them into d equation, then that will become dm lt over v1 x dm. This will equal to v1 m1 dm lt over v1 square dm. So that will be m1 ENLP over D1 square, so 0 to D1. So obviously, we can see that in here, then after integration, the solution becomes this formulation. Very simple and straightforward. So you can see that in here, the first linkage will naturally relate the dimension, number of turns, and also over 3. So that's our over 3 relationship. Next thing you can see that the linkage inductance will therefore equal to divided by current. This basic formula for the linkage inductance. So the first linkage divided by its current becomes the linkage inductance. So once we this division, we will see that then we appear with the M1 squared here. Then the rest of them will be the dimension. So obviously you can see that all the inductors now we see that will proportional to the N squared. No matter the main thrust inductance or the leakage inductance. We are in the air environment, so that's why it's a mu log, we don't have any mu R in here, the rest of them will be the dimension. So that leakage inductance is for the linkage thrust appear in the primary side of the winding. So the whole thing here will therefore deal again using the secondary sign. So the equation will be exactly the same, become like that. We just change the N1 into N2. The dimension, V1 dimension becomes V2 dimension. The rest of them will be the same. So now that we have already developed the linkage method in the primary side and also in the secondary side. The total inductance of quantum summation together, but that's one inductance we need to understand will be the interwinding gap. So interwinding gap will be in here. Within here, with the maximum amount of thrust, this thrust will also contribute to the linkage. So to check how much is that must make it here and how much contribute to the leakage. So that's why what we can see in here. Okay. The numbers here are getting modified by the return link to the area and multiplied by the maximum flux here. So that's the total percentage. So this will become this formulation. And then this kind of the leakage, I assume that we refer everything in the common side, so divide by N1 curve. So that's why primarily the leakage but in the gap area will be equal to this one. So now we're talking all three leakage components, so the primarizing, gap area, and the secondarizing. So we add all together, will therefore become our total induction. Of course, we refer everything back to the common side using this. So you can see that this is the total induction we refer in the primary side. But when we do the measurement, we the difficulty to distinguish between primary and secondary. When we measure it, we are only using the Schwarzschild test. The Schwarzschild test, according to the T model, we just lump two of them together. We don't know how to distinguish only primary or only secondary. So in many cases, this is actually total induction. You divide by half, one portion of the primary side, one portion of the secondary, so that will be equal. That will make the same thing. But this won't be an error because when we do the leakage, we just assume the G model, this tool will contribute to the main part of the current. So even though we assume that it will be equal or not equal, it doesn't bother us. Because we usually, when we calculate leakage induction, we use all of them total together. So that's why this will be good enough for our calculation. So this critical understanding how we calculate leakage for this kind of the equal transform. Any question after this one? So this is like to help you understand how we use the leakage to work out the leakage field. The leakage field we also make this MMF also work out the leakage. This formula, first thing is divided by current, then we work out the leakage induction. So they are all basic and important how we understand for the leakage. In the future, if you want to work out other inductors, then you can also use other methods to do that.
Which is the LT?
So, we take an LT. So anyway, the inductance calculation is really similar to transformer. You see, we are just now learning about the transformer, but of course we have something similar for the inductor as well. But inductor will be a special transformer, only one term. You don't have an technical term. The leakage may not be incorporated in the inductor, so we don't need to go through that in detail. But more importantly, we need to do the loss calculation. The loss for the transformer inductor are quite similar. Even inductor only have one winding, transformer has four winding or more. So in this case, the loss calculation for transformer inductor can be using similar method for the calculation. So that's one equation quite useful as many of all things. First of all, this is a typical equation when we want to look at the FR ratio. So the FR ratio are formulated by this one. This is a full portion here. So this is from our journal paper, which you can see that alpha H is related to the normalized length. So if you want to know detail, then you go through my paper to look into that. So you can see that M is the number of layers. When you do the transform winding, we have to put one layer, and then in low room, there's the second layer and third layer. So in the transformer, we may need to put on many more of the layer. So that means if our transformer is only a single layer, then M square minus M will vanish. Only have this one at the time. But if you have many number of layers, then you can see that this kind of the cumulative effect in the upper layer will affect the bottom layer and cause the very confusion in the MMF. In this case, the cosmic effect will be much higher. So you see that this will more look like the loss due to the from maybe from the skin fat. So this is more close related to the proximity. So as you see in the future, if you want to wire transformer, you can do it only using single layer or winding. So you can eliminate this proximity gap. So because this is the square term really high. With the evaluation of ACVision really high. So that's the thing we do highlight. But this part will be more gentle. You also can increase with the frequency, but more gentle. So for my design, I will tend to use single layer. The main cannot use two, but not too many. So this equation is highly related to a constant, zero constant. For example, like the rho is the sensitivity, and the WS is the term pitch. That means this term, the distance is in two adjacent term. And the rest of them will be something like the dimension, the B entry dimension, then is the number of layers. So that's how we look into that kind of formulation. This formula is very important for the calculate the loss of the data for transform. So actually the losses will equal to the photo for the core loss and copper loss. So just now I only show you about the core loss using our formulation. And then the core loss will be difficult to formulate because there's no physical formula for this one. We usually only use a empirical formula like what we did before. So in theory, just now when we calculate the previous formula, like this one, this is the common formula. So the real part will be the FR ratio and the resistive part. The emergent part will therefore become the emergent. So in theory, there will be another term called the FL ratio. Which this ratio will be used to examine about the emerging part, the leakage in that part. Of course, in this series, we have more focus on the resistance, the power losses part. So this will be your homework. You can use it for your own study. Then, of course, you can go for some more big things, like some skin effects. I think you all know that under the high frequency, the electrical tends to go outside of the skin. So that means most of the current will focus on the outer line. The inside will be looked like a little low current density. So because this one, the current distribution will therefore become like this. So in the middle, a really few current density. In the outside, we have a very high current density. Another event we call it proximity event. So that means it's not an external field, not an internal field. So this field, when we go through conductor, it will be distributed the current due to this kind of the Lenz's law. So that means the current will not be linear, but will be distributed. So this kind of effect will be similar to the equation we have just now. When we have a group of different layers, different layer will contribute to the magnetic field while affecting the other layer. So this is how it will therefore look like. Another thing is when we do the lighting, when the lighting, the simple thing it will be the primary and secondary. So that's how we see in the left diagram. We go up, then going down. The peak here, the BM will become a higher time value. So don't let this time peak value because it constrains for more losses. One thing I can reduce the losses will be using so called self-small mounting. Instead of primary secondary, I can do a primary secondary primary. As long as just I divided the primary into half, one will be here. In this case, I can make the field become more balanced because if using this power, maybe still with the MMF distribution, it can only be there by half. Instead, going to the top here, go to the middle, and then start to go down again, and go back up. So the peak here actually be by half. So in theory, the losses can also be reduced because we use this damage more lighting to reduce the peak value of the density. So if you do it more exaggerating, you can change. So then in this peak and further division. Of course, to do that, they involve more expense for your money management because for primary and secondary, one day you need some isolation. So isolation in many of the standard you require that the cleavage from this point to the next layer, you need some isolation. Some center can be at least 5 mm, some can be at least 10 mm. So then you will lose some of the room in here. So that's how the method you do the writing for the transformer for the method. Another thing we'd like to go through some of the basic terminology for some when you try to find the core from the street, you're able to see something like that. With a leaflet, then of course there's all the geometry given to you. And then they also have different kind of the terminology. For some of them, you put the eccentric wall in. The eccentric wall then is actually in the magnetic wall, where the magnetic field is related to them. And also, LE is the eccentric is in the magnetic uplink. What is the LE? As I mentioned just now, LE is like this. So we have the magnetic field. Will travel the main field, not the leakage field, the main field travel using the term LE. Sometimes I use the terminology in GYLL. AE is the effective area, is the area of the field go through. For some of that, if you look at this transformer, means then that will light up here. So the AE will be like this area. The cross-sectional area of this one will therefore become AE. And then the question we're going to ask you will be, if I set an unit here, the field will go up away. So we've got another area here. What do you think is area A1 and A2? Anyone can tell me the relationship of the AE to A1 and A2? What do you think about it? Then it will transform.
Because it's not in the vicinity.
Because the main thrust will be minus 2.5 to go to A1 and A2. That's why if you look at all the new core, you find that the center knee here is bigger than the two outer knees. Why is that? Because the field in here, even 2.5, one goes to here, one goes here. So that's why in order to make the magnetic thrust density to be equal to over, this area must be double of this area, and double of this area. Okay? So that's one observation you can see there. So that's why the AB is equal to A1, 2 of the A1, equal to 2 of the AB. Then you can ensure that they will be. So in theory, the LE times AE should be equal to VE anyway. In terminology, you can see that in many of data streams, they use AL to represent the inductance. So what's the AL mean in here? Okay. Because the normal inductance equation N squared A over L together with the permittivity. So they try to lump all these parameters in here, A, mu, L in here, call this term called AL. So then the equation for AL will be L will equal to N squared AL. So this will lump together become our AL. But the unit is actually the nano Henry. So because in this case, you don't bother about the detail in here. Here we all know the inductance proportion of N squared. So when you obtain the AL, then you can multiply the number of terms squared, get the inductance. In the terminology, you can see that we've got air gap in here. When the air gap is zero, then that's the maximum amount of air gap. Air gap is the transformer we use it quite often For example, right, we can have a transformer. So we do have an air gap in here. So this gap will therefore reduce the saturation. We use the final sum transformer on the side where about the situation. We will put the air gap here so that the transformer will less chance to get saturated. So because this is quite a high impedance in terms of the measured impedance. So once we do that, the effective inductance or effective inductance coefficient will therefore become reduced. So that's why I can say that the mu effective will be lower, the AM will be much lower. So in some commercial product, they can actually provide you with air gap, and then you can use this air gap automatically, you can get their own inductance factor. So you don't have to use sandpaper, do you? I myself will use sandpaper to adjust my own air gap. Some people may use the paper to adjust the air gap. But you can also buy some commercial product with a different air gap so that you can use that data to get the air. So this is a basic formula for induction. When we have air gap, this formula will be modified. So you can try to go home to see if you're able to modify this equation to become transformed with air gap. So that's also quite interesting. And all based on this one, the sum of parameters is here to be further modified. Okay. This is a very important formula for this design transformer. Firstly, I would like you to understand about this formula. If I want design transformer, I just design the number of turns in the transformer. So that's the end of our own understanding. The most thing applied to the transformer, we know that if our SMPS say 200 volt, 300 volt, that would be 300 volt. And then we choose the number of turns so that the disk plus density will not be go too high. So this is defined by many transformers. If this was divided by area, divided by area, this will give you the value. So most of transformers, as I mentioned before, will prefer you to be 0.1 or 0 something better. Depending on frequency of operation, so that you won't go saturation. So firstly, to choose N according to the limitation for the value. The limitation value is only in the natural somewhere. If you want to design transformer working at about 10 kHz, I prefer the Tesla only 0.1. But if you want to go for megahertz, prefer Tesla or 0.03. Because the more deeper you work out the core losses. So once we know this assumption, then you can therefore use this formula to work out number of turns. Once you choose number of turns, then you can therefore define the transformer number of turns. So that's why I can say that for transformer, it's much easier to design. Why is that? Because these two fields are very sensitive. The fields are canceled of each other. So that means the main core, these two will have much lower flux density compared to the inductor. If you go to the inductor formula, you can see that many design inductors are mainly using this formula to do that. This plus over area will give us the flux density inside the magnetic core for the inductor. So we ensure that for this current pass through, the inductor will not get saturation. So firstly, you calculate when you give a transform to the inductor, you have to use this formula. You say how much current you go through the inductor, and then you see if the saturation appear, check the spine over A to make sure that the flux density will be below the saturation. Or the flux density will not make really high losses in the core. So that means the design for transformer and inductor are different. Inductor, you have to use formulation, and for transformer, you have to use this one. So in many cases, you can see that because the transformer is not so widely to cancel each other the main thrust, so that's why the flux density will be much lower. So in inductor, because we don't have that kind of the effect, so the main thrust are mainly contributed by current, so you So in many cases, for a power converter, for the same kind of power level, the inductor compared to transformer can be much smaller because the new first will be much lower.